and the FBI today still will not release their documents about Robert Maxwell and Promise. That's insane. It's been a really long time. You think they could like release it if there's nothing there, but there obviously is. And one of the reasons, anyway, that he was allowed to access that is because Henry Kissinger told him exactly who to pay off and recruit for Israeli intelligence. So Henry Kissinger is a dirty, rotten traitor to the United States of America. And let us hope that 2023 is the year he finally dies because it's intolerable being on the same planet as him. Anyway.
Tell me.
Trump recently removed Henry Kissinger from the Pentagon's Defense Policy Board. When controlled alt media figures like Alex Jones talk about Kissinger, they'll say he's a globalist, he went to Bilderberg, but they won't actually go into detail about who he is. So that's what I'm going to focus on in this video. A couple of days before Trump fired him, he told Biden to go easy on China. As Richard Nixon's National Security Advisor in 1972, Kissinger helped engineer the president's historic opening to China. But he managed that policy transition, and as an outside advisor to every subsequent president, in a way that arguably has produced America's greatest diplomatic failure and its most dangerous strategic miscalculation. Yet he persists and now offers the same apparently unsolicited advice to President-elect Joe Biden. Kissinger spent the last couple of decades working to ease relations with China. This resulted in much of America's manufacturing being transferred to China. He played a key role in helping Communist China become the economic powerhouse that it is today. Even more interesting, his tribe are the ones who helped China become communist in the first place. Here's an article from the Jewish Daily Forward titled, "A Jew in Mao's China." Quote, "In fact, 85 to 90% of the foreigners helping the Chinese at the time of the communist takeover were Jewish." So the same people who brought communism to Europe also brought it to Asia. This video is not about whether the Vietnam War was right or wrong, or what actually happened on the Gulf of Tonkin. Bear in mind, this video is about geopolitics. Here's an anti-Vietnam War poster designed by the Chinese Communist Party advocating for the withdrawal of US troops. Interestingly, Kissinger's tribe also worked to withdraw US troops from Southeast Asia. Here's an article from the Times of Israel titled, 50 years ago, upstart rabbi used Jewish law to tell Senate to end Vietnam War. Quote, 36-year-old Irving Greenberg was virtually unknown when he told U.S. leaders the Vietnam War dehumanized victims created in the image of God. There are lessons to be learned today. Most likely, Greenberg was there in place of Abraham Joshua Heschel, the white-maned philosopher-theologian of the Jewish Theological Seminary, who was a leading voice in the anti-war movement and the most prominent Jewish interlocutor with Martin Luther King. Heschel was recuperating from a heart attack during the early months of 1970 and was unable to testify. Martin Luther King was a communist, and his handler, Abraham Heschel, wasn't just promoting Marxist-Leninism in the US. He was also trying to end US military involvement in Southeast Asia, which resulted in communists taking over Vietnam, Laos, and Cambodia. Take a look at this sign the guy beside him is holding. It says, "Restore full religious and cultural freedom to Russian Jews." Greenberg testified on May 7, 1970, at a hearing entitled, "Moral and Military Aspects of the War in Southeast Asia." The hearing came just 3 days after four students at Kent State University were shot and killed by members of the Ohio National Guard during campus protests against the Vietnam War. Three of the four students killed, Sandra Scheuer, Allison Krauss, and Jeffrey Miller, were Jewish. We're seeing almost the same thing today with these Antifa uprisings. Difference is, this time around the National Guard is very liberalized. they're using tear gas instead of bullets. And that's if the National Guard is even called in. Some Democrat governors refuse to activate the National Guard and instead allow small businesses to be destroyed. So why did China and Kissinger's tribe want US troops out of the region? Because China and the Soviet Union were arming North Vietnam as it was trying to take over the South. With American troops gone, the communists would be able to take over the rest of the country. And that is exactly what happened. Better yet, Kissinger was the one who made it happen. October 8, 1972, the long-standing diplomatic stalemate between Henry Kissinger and Leduc Tho finally ends as both sides agree to major concessions. The US will allow North Vietnamese troops already in South Vietnam to remain there, while North Vietnam drops its demand for the removal of South Vietnam's President Tio and the dissolution of his government. Although Kissinger's staff members privately expressed concerns over allowing NVA troops to remain in the South, Kissinger rebuffs them, saying, "I want to end this war before the election." October 22, 1972, in Saigon, Kissinger visits President Tio to discuss the peace proposal. Meetings between Kissinger and Tio go badly as an emotional Tio adamantly opposes allowing North Vietnamese troops to remain indefinitely in South Vietnam. An angry Kissinger reports Tio's reaction to President Nixon, who then threatens Tio with a total cutoff of all American aid. But Tio does not back down. Kissinger then returns to Washington. This was not a peace deal at all. Kissinger basically gifted Vietnam to the Soviet Union and China. The reason President Tio was emotional is because allowing the invaders to remain in South Vietnam would guarantee they would take over the country. Even Kissinger's staff knew this was going to happen. December 13, 1974. North Vietnam violates the Paris Peace Treaty and tests President Ford's resolve by attacking Phuoc Long Province in South Vietnam. President Ford responds with diplomatic protests, but no military force in compliance with the congressional ban on all US military activity in Southeast Asia. The anti-war group successfully pressured Congress into banning US military activity in Southeast Asia, resulting in a victory for the Soviet Union and China's satellite North Vietnam. And most of the anti-war groups in the US back then were working for Soviet intelligence. Just like how most of today's anti-war groups in the US are working for Russian intelligence. I've already shown you so much evidence of this on my channel. Here's Medea Benjamin, co-founder of Code Pink, a left-wing Jewish group which works with Russian state-owned media. They brag that Russia is their friend. And they campaigned to stop military aid to Ukraine just after it was invaded by Russia. These anti-war groups are blatantly working in favor of Russia's geopolitical interests. The Kremlin tried to use anti-war groups to manipulate the US into abandoning its ally in Ukraine, just as they got the US to abandon its ally in South Vietnam. Here's an article titled, "Vietnamese Communist Leader Says US Anti-War Activists Helped Their Victory." Quote, "In the weeks leading up to Memorial Day and President Barack Obama's scheduled trip to Vietnam, a prominent Viet Cong communist leader privately thanked American anti-war activists for helping defeat the US allied government in Vietnam in the 1970s, saying protest demonstrations throughout the United States were extremely important in contributing to Vietnam's victory." The highest levels of the anti-war groups were communists, but the majority of the protesters were leftists who honestly believed that they were helping bring peace to the world. In reality, these liberals paved the way for re-education camps, forced labor, and mass executions. After the US pulled out of Southeast Asia, even more people died. In Cambodia, for example, approximately 1.7 million people lost their lives. That was roughly 21% of their population. Communism in Asia and Europe has killed roughly 65 million people total, and some say the actual number is even higher than that. 7 years ago, when I first found alternative media, I actually used to watch Russia Today and follow these people. Back then, I honestly believed that the American troops in Vietnam were evil. But now that I'm older, I realize that in every war, innocent people are caught in the crossfire. And every country's military has its share of psychopaths. But Russian state media only focuses on US atrocities and completely ignores important details of the conflict. Why? Because they want to manipulate you. Here's an article titled, Kerry's Soviet Rhetoric, written by Ion Mihai Pasepa, former acting chief of Soviet Romania's espionage service and national security advisor to the country's president. Quote, on April 12, 1971, Kerry told the US Congress that American soldiers claimed to him that they had raped, cut off ears, cut off heads, taped wires from portable telephones to human genitals and turned on the power, cut off limbs, blew up bodies, randomly shot civilians, razed villages in a fashion reminiscent of Genghis Khan. The exact sources of that assertion should be tracked down. Kerry also ought to be asked who exactly told him any such thing, and what it was exactly that they said they did in Vietnam. As a spy chief and a general in the former Soviet satellite of Romania, I produced the very same vitriol Kerry repeated to the US Congress almost word for word and planted it in leftist movements throughout Europe. KGB chairman Yuri Andropov managed our anti-Vietnam War operation. He often bragged about having damaged the US foreign policy consensus, poisoned domestic debate in the US, and built a credibility gap between America and European public opinion through our disinformation operations. Vietnam was, he once told me, our most significant success.
You know, the Armed Forces Radio and the newspaper, they kind of kept things from you, you know? So we, you know, from the letters I got home, there was protesters, but I didn't think it was that bad.
Coming home was like coming home to a different country. In 68, it seemed like there was so much going on back home that I didn't know about, that it was Martin Luther King had been assassinated, Robert Kennedy had been assassinated. I didn't know any of that. And the people themselves, they didn't look like the same. They had all long hair. They were all screaming, get back on the plane, you baby killer, throwing tomatoes at you. You name it, that's what they did. Mainly on the West Coast.
When I came back 13 months later, it was like coming back to a whole different civilization. You know, and so, you know, I wasn't here. I certainly could have been impressed by it as it was developing. And it was a real shock to my system to see how this country had gone from some casual disobedience to massive disobedience.
They are experts at playing off your emotions. They turned you against your veterans, and now they're turning you against your police, provoking massive disobedience. This is engineered chaos. I don't care if someone is anti-war. My issue is that the anti-war movement is full of Soviet disinformation. In this photo, these anti-war protesters are portraying Saigon, South Vietnam, as a puppet of US imperialism. In reality, South Vietnam wanted to be closer to the West, and they were the ones asking the US for help. President Thieu, once again threatened by Nixon with a total cutoff of American aid to South Vietnam, now unwillingly accepts the peace agreement, which still allows North Vietnamese troops to remain in South Vietnam. Thieu labels the terms tantamount to surrender for South Vietnam. The Kremlin's anti-war movement will make it out as if the US is illegally occupying much of the world. But in reality, many of these countries are begging the US for military assistance. Poland is paying for American troops to be stationed on their soil. Why? Because they want a deterrent against Russia. Here's an article titled, Competition Heats Up to Host US Troops in Europe. Quote, Poland is already in line to receive some of the 9,500 troops that US President Donald Trump plans to withdraw from Germany following disagreements over defense spending levels. Now Latvia says it too would like to be under consideration. Poland and the Baltic states are willing to pay for US troops as a deterrent against Russia. Just as South Korea and Japan are paying for US troops as a deterrent against North Korea and China, respectively. That is why Russian state media pays Americans to promote isolationist views, because this actually benefits Russia geopolitically. Look at Ron Paul, for example. He's anti-intervention for the US, but all of a sudden he's pro-intervention when it comes to Russia. He often claims that it's immoral for the US to violate international law in order to secure its interests, but then he supports Russia violating international law in order to secure its interests in Crimea. He's a hypocrite. If he was honest and said, look, I support Russia's illegal annexation of Crimea because I'm on Team Russia, I would not have a problem with it. Now back to Poland. Duda has been cozying up to Trump for the past 2 years, asking for more troops. Yet the Kremlin's agents and alt-media tell you the complete opposite of the truth. They claim that the US is the one forcing its will on Poland.
Trump is going to use you. He's going to try and use you as a way of attacking Russia. The biggest problem in Poland is Russophobia. That's the biggest problem. I understand why you feel the way you do about Russians. Okay, I understand that.
Yeah.
But that was then, and this is now. And the biggest threat to world peace is not Russia right now. It's the United States of America.
E. Michael Jones said, that is then, and this is now, claiming that Russia is no longer hostile to Poland. Well, let's go to Alexander Dugin, former geopolitical advisor to Putin and others in the Kremlin for more than a decade. Here's an interview he did with the Polish magazine Fronda. For the sake of time, I'm just going to read quotes. Link to the full interview will be pinned in the comment section. That's our job. Unite with Germany and create a powerful continental bloc. What about Poland then? There should be some Russification. Russia, in its geopolitical and sacral geographic development, is not interested in the existence of an independent Polish state in any form. It is also not interested in the existence of Ukraine. Not because we don't like Poles or Ukrainians, but because these are the laws of sacred geography and geopolitics. Poland has to choose either Slavic or Catholic identity. If Poland insists on keeping its identity, this will make everyone hostile to each other and become a conflict zone once again. The Kremlin wants to create a powerful continental bloc from Russia to Germany. They would need pro-Russian governments in the countries between, but that's most likely not going to happen. So realistically, they would have to plow through the rest of Ukraine, the Baltic states, and Poland. But they can't do that right now because of NATO. That's why in Russia today, they demonize NATO more than anything else in the world. If you watch their videos and read their comment section, you'll notice that they are constantly promoting the breakup of NATO. If that were to happen, Russia then would be able to dominate Europe. RT used to be called Soviet Russia Today. It was always a propaganda outlet for the Kremlin. Remember when Dugin said, that's our job, unite with Germany and create a powerful continental bloc? Now listen closely to what Jones says here.
First of all, Donald Trump is absolutely right when he says that NATO is obsolete. It became obsolete in 1991 when the Soviet Union collapsed. It's been used as a weapon of Western aggression against Russia ever since, and so he's right, it deserves to go out of existence. Secondly, I think we need to contemplate the tragic figure of Angela Merkel. Unlike what Donald Trump says, she was not a great leader. She did not represent Germany's interests at all during the last few years. She was a vassal of the United States, and as a vassal of the United States, she pursued a disastrous policy for Germany, namely alienating Russia. Germany needs Russia.
Jones has worked with Dugin in Iran, and he promotes Dugin's talking points for Germany. He also promotes Russia's geopolitical objectives for Poland and NATO. Jones has done great work in the past about who's behind the porn industry, but right now he's clearly a mouthpiece for the Kremlin. There's a reason Poland's intelligence services are wary of Russia. It's not because they're Russophobic, as Jones claims. Back to the Dugin interview, quote, "I think that the best thing in Polish history is the Jewish tradition in small towns in eastern Poland. Actually, I am interested in everything that was anti-Catholic in Poland, Polish Freemasons and occultists." In a word, from your point of view, all anti-Catholic activities in Poland are beneficial? Exactly. You have to break Catholicism from the inside, strengthen Polish Freemasonry. Anyway, my friends in Poland tell me that there are groups with you that are related to Telemism or the achievements of Aleister Crowley. Notice the star on his hat?
Я прошу почтить память умершего Алистера Кроули минутой молчания. Если есть в зале какие-нибудь зажигалки и спички, вы можете зажечь и минуту помолчать.
О мой Бог, един Твой исток, един Твой дух, едино Твое изменение. Позволь мне воспеть Твои совершенства перед людьми. В образе шестиконечной звезды, сверкающей сквозь глупые своды, позволь мне объявить о Твоих совершенствах.
Most people don't understand geopolitics. If the US doesn't work with its allies, then communists in Russia and China would dominate the world. Some haters will try to call me a neocon, but I actually don't support invading countries for Israel. You know who does? Henry Kissinger. He was anti-war for Vietnam, so the Soviet Union and China could strengthen their influence in that part of the world. But then he was pro-war for Iraq, so Israel could strengthen its influence in that part of the world. According to Bob Woodward's book, State of Denial, Mike Gerson asked Kissinger why he supported the Iraq War. Because Afghanistan wasn't enough, Kissinger answered. In the conflict with radical Islam, he said, they want to humiliate us, and we need to humiliate them. The war on terror also got the US intelligence community to take their focus off of communism and shift it towards radical Islam. This has allowed the US to become severely infiltrated. Kissinger is so high up that he was chosen to be the chairman of the commission intended to investigate the 9/11 attacks. But he resigned because he did not want to reveal the clients of his consulting firm. So we won't know exactly where he's getting his money from. Kissinger is also a Zionist. He performed the introduction when Joe Biden was presented with the Theodore Herzl Award. We know he's close to Israel, we know he's close to China, and he's also close to Russia. This is from 2012, quote, "Prime Minister Vladimir Putin will meet Friday with former Secretary of State Henry Kissinger to discuss world affairs, including elections in Russia and the United States," said Mr. Putin's press secretary, Dmitry Peskov. Mr. Peskov said Mr. Kissinger requested the meeting in late November or early December. The two men are old friends who have met 8 or 10 times over the years, once dining at Mr. Kissinger's home in New York. Mr. Putin has cited Mr. Kissinger as a trusted foreign policy advisor. In the book First Person, Mr. Putin admiringly recalled a conversation in the early 1990s when, as an aide to the mayor of St. Petersburg, Mr. Putin was asked to pick up Mr. Kissinger at the airport. Mr. Kissinger made a strong impression by saying that he, too, had gotten his start in intelligence, and that he felt Mikhail Gorbachev had been too hasty in withdrawing Soviet forces from Eastern Europe. Now here's a 2016 Russia Today article about their relationship. Quote, Russian President Vladimir Putin has continued his long-standing friendly relations with former U.S. Secretary of State Henry Kissinger, as the pair took the opportunity to talk at a meeting in his residence outside Moscow. The meeting is a continuation of a friendly dialogue between President Putin and Henry Kissinger, who are bound by a long-standing relationship, said Kremlin spokesman Dmitry Peskov. They communicate all the time. Use the opportunity to talk, he added. Putin values this opportunity to discuss pressing international issues as well as exchange opinions on global perspectives, Peskov said. Putin and Kissinger have had over 10 TTATT meetings so far, according to media reports. When Kissinger visited Russia in 2013, Putin said that Moscow always pays attention to his opinion and called the former Secretary of State a world-class politician. Kissinger, a former U.S. National Security Advisor and foreign policy head, pioneered the détente policy in 1969, steering the U.S.-Soviet relations to a general ease. RT wrote this in 2016. In 1984, 32 years prior, KGB defector Anatoly Galitsyn wrote, the communist strategic motive then was to involve President Nixon in political détente and accommodation simultaneously with China and the USSR, and to induce him, a leading exponent of anti-communism, to abandon the anti-communist element in U.S. foreign policy. That's exactly what Nixon did, and his national security advisor, Kissinger, made it happen. Kissinger is the man who carried out this KGB objective. Now let's look at how Kissinger opened up relations with China in the first place. What he did is referred to as the Sino-Soviet split. China pretended to oppose the Soviet Union in order to improve relations with the West. Kissinger then sold this to Nixon and future presidents. If you don't believe me, check out his own words. In an interview, Kissinger said, and so we concluded that probably the Soviets were the aggressors. Once that was established in our mind, we concluded that in a conflict between two communist giants, the rules of equilibrium, which Americans usually don't recognize, but the rules of equilibrium require that we back the weaker against the stronger. It's no great insight for Britishers, but in America, that is not the way foreign policy is usually perceived. And then from then on, we started moving actively and took measures to find means of contact with the Chinese. In New Lies for Old, Galitsyn also writes, Communist China is not a strategic partner, but a concealed strategic enemy of the United States. China will join the Soviet offensive to bring about restructuring in the United States and worldwide. Now check out this headline. Russia, China embrace uneasily, aim for desirable world order. Moscow-Beijing relations are showing dynamic growth, according to Chinese leader Xi Jinping. He also described Vladimir Putin as a close friend. Many of you have heard about the Great Reset. In that video released by the World Economic Forum titled, 8 Predictions for the World in 2030, they said that the US won't be the world's leading superpower, and that a handful of countries will dominate. Whose goal is that again? When the US collapses, the countries that will dominate the world will be Russia, China, and Israel. For this great reset, most of the tech we'll be using in the future will be Israeli technology. Israel dominates in that field. If you haven't seen my past video on Israel, China, and the Belt and Road Initiative, link will be pinned in the comments section. It's not just Marxists on the left who are promoting this restructuring agenda. Kremlin's agents on the far right are also promoting it. Andrew Anglin wrote on Russia Insider, quote, COVID spells end of US globalist horror show. Russia and China are equal players now. Who enabled that to happen? China and the World Health Organization lied and allowed this flu to spread. Here's one of their tweets from January 10th, quote, WHO does not recommend any specific health measures for travelers to and from Wuhan, China? Here's one from January 14th, quote, preliminary investigations conducted by the Chinese authorities have found no clear evidence of human-to-human transmission of the novel coronavirus identified in Wuhan, China. Now, I'm not one of those people pitting this conspiracy entirely on China. Most of you noticed that after China released the virus, elites in the Western world began taking advantage of it. Remember when I showed you how Kissinger's tribe and China are in bed with each other? Well, some of the Western elites are involved in that romance as well. Klaus Schwab, founder of the World Economic Forum, wrote a book titled COVID-19, The Great Reset. He also admitted that Henry Kissinger was one of his most important teachers who changed his thinking.
I have met practically every leader in the last 40 years, and there were only three or four leaders who really made a lasting impression on me and to a certain extent changed my thinking. And one of those was Mandela, another one was my teacher at Harvard 50 years ago, Professor Henry Kissinger.
Another Western elite promoting this great reset is Canadian Prime Minister Justin Trudeau. He's another corrupt politician getting himself and his friends rich. He doesn't care if his country turns into another Venezuela. It doesn't look like he cares about the middle class, and that's who I think this will affect the most. If you look at the UN goals promoted by the WEF, no poverty, education reform, gender equality, anti-racism, climate change, these are blatantly Marxist causes meant to weaken historically strong Western nations. See the UN's logo? Pay close attention.
I don't know how many people noticed the striking similarity between the emblem of United Nations and emblem of the USSR. You think it's coincidence? The symbolism is obvious, unless you are blind, of course. Yeah.
If you enjoy my presentations and appreciate me spending so much time doing research for other people, instead of freeloading, you can subscribe to my Patreon for as little as $1 a month. You will then gain access to exclusive videos, because from now on, a lot of my best content will not be posted onto YouTube. I have to eat too. I can't afford to keep doing charity. To close this off, remember Aleister Crowley from earlier? Well, he was on the cover of a Beatles album. John Lennon was in the Beatles. Now listen closely to his song, Imagine.